They were all bright as the dickens could come up with ideas. I knew I had this show when I did the audition, just simply from that feeling that I had felt.
Within weeks of its premiere, The Douglas Show was breaking local audience records. The show's host, Mike Douglas, and producer Woody Frazier had a hit. The show became so popular that Westinghouse launched it nationally in 1963, making Douglas the king of daytime TV, not only in Cleveland, but around the country.
They had a station in Cleveland, they had a station in Pittsburgh, they had a station in Baltimore, they had a station in Boston, and they had a station in San Francisco. And we went on all those stations, and the same thing happened. The show took off immediately.
Well,
immediately.
Come on, get ready.
And then they went, went syndicated, and their stations were just coming in from like wildfire. But that's what was wonderful. Instead of going full network, to do it that way, that impetus kept going, and there was such excitement with the show. I mean, I could not wait to get into that studio every day.
During his remarkable 23-year run, including the first five in Cleveland, Douglas interviewed more than 30,000 guests and helped launch the careers of many big-name stars, including the great Barbara Streisand, who was paid $1,000 to co-host five 90-minute shows.
And when that red light came on, I get chills when I talk about this. The sounds that came out of this woman. She'd walk through the rehearsal, just nod like this, and I think, oh. And the whole week she did that, she'd come in and go. And then the light would go on, bingo. I mean, it was like sounds from heaven. I hate to repeat this, but somebody at this very station who's no longer here, we don't have to worry about mentioning him, he's in the wine business, and he should have been then. He actually said he took those tapes and he erased them, five 90-minute tapes with Barbara Streisand, to make editorials. It hurts here when I talk about it, and it's the truth.
Angie Dickinson.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is KYW Cleveland, a Group W station, Westinghouse Broadcasting in Cleveland. That's the last time you'll hear that. It's 5 o'clock and happy days.
In 1965, just 10 years after trading ownership of stations in Cleveland and Philadelphia, the FCC ordered NBC to return to Cleveland and Westinghouse to return to Philadelphia. When NBC returned as our owner, we became WKYC-TV. Not only did Westinghouse take our KYW call letters with them to Philadelphia, they also took along one of our most popular personalities.
I didn't want to go. I wanted to stay here. Wally Cannan in Philadelphia didn't want to come here. And I called him one day, and he was on vacation. So I never talked to him before the switch. Or he might have stayed in Philly, and I would have stayed right here. But I went to Philadelphia. People were great to me. But after a few months, I thought, why am I doing this when I had offers to come back? As it turned out, come back to three, and I didn't think Wally wanted me here, Wally Cannan, or five or eight, and I'm such a sports nut, eight had the Browns. I decided to go to eight with Ken Coleman. I signed up, he quit a month after I signed up.
The following program is brought to you in living color on NBC.
Within months of NBC's return to Cleveland, a whole new era began. Television in living color. Channel 3 became Cleveland's first all-color station.
Thank heavens. For little girls, they grow up in the most delightful way.
Also during the mid-1960s, WKYC station management saw another opportunity for community involvement. The locally produced documentary series. For the following 13 years, Montage would reign as one of the highest rated series of its kind in the country, while winning many of the broadcasting industry's major awards. Even though the Montage staff covered thousands of miles and several continents, their stories always had a special connection to our community.
Thank you, Tom.
Thank you, Del.
For being here.
and for the memories.
It's been a joy.
This is Channel 3 News.
Good evening, everyone. Jill took the night off. I'm Connie Deacon, and that's our robotic camera. Good evening.
And now with a report on what the bad economy is doing to apprentice programs in our area, here is Doug in the Action 3 newsroom.
I can't hear any audio if it means anything. I'm trying to warn people we're in trouble.
He's warned me. I hope you got the message as well.
How much of your money would have been saved had CEI elected to build, say, a coal-burning power plant? A coal-burning power plant would have saved... Excuse me. Coal-burning power plant might have saved a lot of money. Tomorrow we're going to take a look at just how much money would have been saved when we take a look at that difference. Dale and Doreen?
All right, Jimmy. Thank you very much.
Now stay tuned as Judd Hembrick joins us to salute the men and women who covered the events that changed our lives.
Welcome back to Channel 3's Golden Years, our 50th anniversary celebration. Once television success was assured, network and local station executives saw a new opportunity for expansion and community involvement, TV news. And to guide us through five decades of big stories is a man who has reported the news in Cleveland for longer than 20 years, Channel 3's Judd Hembrick.
Thanks, Del. The first WNBK TV news broadcasts were little more than staff announcers reading headlines from the wire services. And many times entire newscasts were sponsored by local advertisers. On WNBK, Cadillac sponsored the evening news with Tom Fields. Joe Mulvihill reported the big boy sports. And Joe Finan was the Atlantic weatherman.
The WNBK TV news department had its first opportunity to cover a major national story when a local murder became one of the country's biggest and most sensational headlines. The year was 1954.
The Shepherd murder trial had got totally out of hand. It was a media circus in its day. And Judge Ed Blythen, who was really over his head in handling the case, did one smart thing. At the end of the trial, he sealed the courthouse.
We, the jury in this case, being duly impaneled and sworn, do find the defendant, Sam H. Shepherd, not guilty of murder in the first degree, but guilty of murder in the second degree, James C. Byrd Forman.
So Ed Wallace, our news director, Sandy Markey, the assistant news director, had covered the entire trial. They would come back at the end of the day and sit down, write a story, and do it on the air. Well, they're stuck in the courthouse. They want to get this on the air. We interrupt howdy doody. Well, you didn't do that. You know, had there been an 11th commandment, that would have been it. But here I am, interrupting howdy doody, reading a page of copy cold, and it was kind of a frightening way to make one's debut on network television.
Like the Shepherd murder trial, we have shared so many incredible stories with you over the past 50 years. Many of those stories had tremendous impact on our lives. Some touched us deeply, some made us laugh, while others brought tears. This is our tribute to the headlines of the past 50 years and to the men and women who reported them with style, grace, and compassion.
Hello, I'm Tom Field. I report the news on KYW-TV, Channel 3 in Cleveland.
I, Dwight D. Eisenhower, do solemnly swear.
Oh, oh, mercy, mercy.
Thank God Almighty!
I shall resign the presidency effective at noon tomorrow.
They didn't put me in there so that I could sell out the soul of the city.
All things and what they
So, who can forget the places television has taken us, or the faces it has shown? Television has taken us around the corner, around the country, and even to the moon. Over the years, I've had the good fortune to work with many of the men and women of Channel 3 News who have reported the events of our community and our world. And we are honored to have a few of Cleveland's best share some of their memories with us tonight.
TV3 presents the award-winning 11th Hour Report with Doug Adair and Virgil Domino.
Good evening.
The shooting of Martin Luther King was just a great shock in the newsroom. I can remember, you know, wails of horror. People just didn't, seasoned reporters could not believe that that had happened.
Martin Luther King Jr. was killed tonight in Memphis, Tennessee.
And we immediately went out into the streets of Cleveland and into the black community and got all kinds of reaction to that. And then, of course, the Hough riots. Where that was a very difficult time in Cleveland, very hard to cover, and was a time of real tragedy. And it's good to see that we progressed, you know, so much from then.
I came into the newsroom one day. There's a letter. It says Eddie Watkins, and he says, by the time you've read this letter, I will have robbed a bank in that lousy city of yours, and I'll be out of town. Of course, he was talking about Cleveland. And so then, a day or two later, I think it was, we hear that he's been surrounded down in a Medina cornfield, and we go down there with our cameras. This was back in the early days of the live remotes, and we did our entire show, and you could look behind me and see Eddie Watkins climbing out of his car, throwing this money up in the air, and there was such a wind that it took it back through the rows of corn, and you could see the FBI agents down on their hands and knees crawling through trying to recover this money. And finally, Eddie comes out with a gun, but he's just trying to give himself up, and he falls over just as they start to shoot, and he gets wounded a little bit, but not seriously. Here was a man who was just another human being, and yes, he robbed banks and he was in prison and all that. But I thought, you know, it was a nice thing to write him occasionally, and he would write and tell me about what was happening to him in prison.
One day, we were assigned to cover a story out in Ashtabula County. Cameraman Dave Hollis and I flew out in the helicopter in what could charitably be described as a blizzard. And by the time we got back after shooting the story, there was about a foot and a half more snow on the ground and heavy winds and everything else. And the helicopter started to take off. He moved around to get away from some wires, and we were maybe 10, 15 feet off the ground, and the helicopter just went over.
The helicopter started tipping very slowly down toward the right side. It was a bang, and the helicopter ended up just as you see it right there. Fortunately, none of us was hurt very badly. I got a little cut in the head. Dave has a scratch in the leg, I think. And there sits NewsHawk 3.
Of course, the history of Channel 3 would never be complete without a moment or two with our beloved Dell's folks. For 30 years, Del Donahue has traveled the highways and back roads of our viewing area. He's made a career of reporting on the lives of everyday people, telling their stories in a way that only Del can do. Del also has been a firm believer in the term reporter involvement. This story nearly cost Del his life. My heavens, what in the world was going on in your mind when that lion had your head in his mouth?
A combination, shock, fear, disbelief, all that sort of thing. But the lion, Fester, had a great time.
I can imagine. What about your scar there? You have a permanent reminder.
Yeah, it'll be there the rest of my life, I'm sure. Just one of those unpredictable things that you know about so well. Thank you, Judd. As Judd well knows, some of the most unpredictable and spontaneous moments of any newscast usually occur during the weather forecast.